Okay, welcome. We're going to do drawing pharmacology. Again, these videos are not final videos. We're just kind of working through some of the things that we'll need and trying to, you know, use generation, synthesis, the higher end of Bloom's taxonomy as we think through these, try to remember them. So for respiratory, before we get into any of the medications, and the medications we'll go through are going to be the antihistamines, allergic rhinitis, decongestant, and then we'll talk a little bit about cough, steroids and inflammation, bronchoconstriction, asthma, COPD. We'll talk about, and I'll explain all these drawings later, but that we can treat bronchoconstriction alone or inflammation alone, and then we'll have some more drugs a little bit later. Okay, so the first thing we want to do, a while back, my students came up with the antihistamine snowman. I don't know where they came up with that thought, but noticing that there's one carrot for the nose and then two buttons, to remember that H1 antihistamine, or histamine 1, is like loratadine, which is brand Claritin, and it only has one I, letter I, so tadine, versus H2, which is an H2 blocker for GI acid reduction, that's T-I-D-I-N-E, or two I's. So we want to be very careful to make sure that we're not confusing H1 versus H2, histamine 1 versus histamine 2 antagonists. And then every once in a while, a student will confuse H1, H2 with first and second generation. You could call this third generation in here a little bit. We're not going to call anything third generation. It gets a little bit confusing. But we'll start with the first generation. So the first generation crosses the blood-brain barrier into the brain. And that's what causes that sedation. So something like diphenhydramine, which is Benadryl, causes this drowsiness, although in children sometimes it'll cause the opposite effect. And then another example is hydroxyzine. Usually we see hydroxyzine for itching or something like that. And that's Atarax. And I, for whatever reason, I always think of Rax and rash to remember that hydroxyzine is for some kind of rash or some kind of itching. The second generations, I put them in alphabetical order. There's cetirizine, which matches up to levocetirizine or levocetirizine. That's Zyrtec and Zizol. And then there's desloratadine and loratadine, which is Clarinex versus Claritin. I don't think desloratadine took off as much as levocetirizine. And it might be because of the Zizol Al. I don't know if you see the commercials. And then fexofenadine is Allegra. So let's go through them. I just put them in alphabetically. Cetirizine with a C, so Zyrtec. Desloratadine, this is Claritin, except they took out the TI and put an EX, so an excellent Claritin, or it was supposed to be the next generation of Claritin, maybe. But it, I don't know if it really took off. Fexofenadine, this is an important one that we use for children, for over-the-counter allergies, things like that. And then you can see the word allergy sort of in there in Allegra. And Allegra is also something that you like. Might be a Disney princess, I don't know. Loratadine, this is the one that really, I feel like this one came first, as the first generation, which is Claritin. You hear the commercials, Claritin Clear. And then on the box, you see a bright blue sky and then the grass and everything's green. And then levocetirizine, they've got the Zizol Owl. And for whatever reason, that seems to be a good image. But the big difference between second and first generation drowsiness versus non-drowsy, we don't want truck drivers with allergies to fall asleep at the wheel. Allergic rhinitis will divide into acute versus prophylaxis. So if we have some kind of congestion, and this is really decongestants, oxymetazoline, which is Afrin, you're not supposed to use it for more than 3 days because you get this rebound congestion. You may need to use a steroid if you do have that effect. Phenylephrine is the PE in many of the over-the-counter medications. And this comes also as neosinephrine. And then pseudoephedrine is brand Sudafed. You have to go behind the counter. You'll also see this as the hyphen D for decongestant on something like Claritin D. Okay. For prophylaxis, really there's no better drug than an intranasal glucocorticoid or a steroid. And I put in green where it's not really technically a stem, but it's something that you might see. So budesonide, fluticasone, mometasone, triamcinolone. You see those a lot with the steroids. But rhine for nose, cort for corticosteroid, flow for you're going to now be able to, the air is going to be able to flow in the nose, nase, naso, next, so the next generation of nasal or something for the nose, and then nasocort, nasal corticosteroid, allergy 24 hour. It's pretty explicit what it's going to do. So the division you really want to make is the decongestant, which will clear up the nose right away, versus prophylaxis long term. Might take a couple of weeks for those to work. Then we get into cough, and I just think of kind of that break at the bronchi, and then that making kind of a upside down C, so C for cough. And the first thing that you might take is guaifenesin with dextromethorphan over the counter, or this is Robitussin DM, could also be Mucinex DM, that's another brand name. Guaifenesin with codeine is Cheritussin AC. There are a number of different names for this. This comes after the cherry flavoring. Hydrocodone with chlorpheniramine is combining a first generation antihistamine that'll make someone drowsy with hydrocodone, which will also make someone drowsy. And then they take the TUS because it's an antitussive. And then I guess it's the next generation, but this is when we really have some kind of severe cough that the codeine didn't help or the over-the-counter medication didn't help. Benzonatate, I was a Dungeons & Dragons kid, so those little pearls, they're little yellow pearls, and they're actually tough to get on the counting tray, but you spell it P-E-R-L-E-S, and the Teslon pearls are something that actually kind of numbs the throat to help prevent the cough. So those four are cough, and then we go into, this is my steroid fire, if you want to think of a campfire, and then we'll get to our bronchoconstrictor, boa constrictor, and those are the two components of asthma. Now we use steroids for all kinds of things, but this is just a way to remember it. And dexamethasone brand Decadron is, I just put these in alphabetical order, dexamethasone, methylprednisolone, prednisolone, and then prednisone. So the methylprednisolone you might find in a ready-made pack. When I got poison ivy, I would get a Medrol dose pack. Prednisolone we usually see for children. Oropred is a liquid, and then prednisone you can find as a tablet. So a number of different ways that we use these, but really getting that the sone or the pred is really your clue to remind you this is a steroid. Then we have the inhalation, and I want to separate inhalation by itself. So you can have budesonide, which is pulmicort flexhaler, or you can have fluticasone, which is flow vent. Now, a lot of test prep books tell you you only have to know the generic, but that's problematic because there's fluticasone, which is flow vent, which is an inhaler, versus fluticasone, which is a nasal steroid, which is flow nase. And then it gets even more complicated where we can have fluticasone propionate, which lasts 12 hours as part of something that has a steroid and a beta 2 agonist, which is a bronchodilator. So this salmeterol or salmeterol, which is an Advair, or if you have the furoate, which is with valanterol, the ultra long acting beta 2 agonist in Brio Ellipta. So the way to keep these straight is to think, where is it going to happen? So we had the nasal one with the nose over there. We have the inhalation alone here. So this is just for inflammation. So this is fire alone, inflammation alone, whether it's one of these oral forms or one of these inhaled forms. Then we can combine this inflammation with the bronchodilator, the bronchoconstricting boa constrictor, budesonide and formoterol, which is Symbicort. And symbiosis is when two things come together, work together. Or you can add things together to get air, which is Advair. Or Brio Ellipta, I'm not sure what that is and how it works with the name, but this is the ultra long acting valanterol. And it's nice that it goes alphabetically from these kind of every 12 hour BID drugs to this every 24 hour, very, very long acting. And you can think of V for very long acting. You can also get these bronchodilators alone. Albuterol, which is ProAir HFA. HFA is hydrofluoroalkane, and if you've been around a while, you may remember that CFCs or chlorofluorocarbons, which were a refrigerant, would actually have a cold sensation. So it's important that the patient know that that cold sensation isn't there if they were used to it before. And then levalbuterol is supposed to be a better form of albuterol, and you see the word open to help open the airways, but then remember that we need to do these 1 minute apart. Now, you can also climb the tropical tree, is the way that I remember these. And we've got albuterol, which is our bronchodilator for the bronchoconstriction, the boa constrictor. And then we have ipratropium. And this tropium, we don't really need to get into it too much, but this is an anticholinergic. So if you remember atropine, that's a tertiary. This is going to be a quaternary, just like you have ammonia versus ammonium. So if you think of the ammonium as the quaternary form, but this ipratropium is short acting and goes in duo neb, that N should be capitalized, but albuterol plus ipratropium. So my kids, when they came out of NICU, were on duo neb. Two different ways, bronchodilating, working against the muscarinic system to open up the airways. But the CLI is from something like aclidinium, which is Tidorza. This is actually, I think, long-acting versus the ipratropium, which is short-acting. And this is Atrovent, which can come as an inhaler. There's also something called Tiotropium, and that is actually long-acting Spiriva. Okay, so we can have this bronchodilator with the tropical tree, or we can have the bronchodilator alone. Short-acting, long-acting, you kind of have to remember. We have a place in Ankeny called Zamarix, so I thought of Zamor respiratory drugs because these don't really fit in neatly anywhere. The leukotriene antagonists like Zafirlucast and Montelukast, normally I put them in alphabetical order, but just to put the Z in there. So the Z for Zafirlucast is acylate. This one you had to use BID, and then Montelukast came along. You can think of mon for mono or singulaire for single dose that you only have to give once a day. Then omalizumab is for severe allergies. It's by injection. There's black box warning that you may need epinephrine later with it, or you need it certainly handy if you're initially giving it. But you can see the air in here, and then also the stems, the LI, the ZU, and MAB, monoclonal antibody, they all have meaning. And then we just use the R to remind us this is respiratory, Zamor respiratory drugs, and then epinephrine, of course, for anaphylaxis. So again, this is just kind of a sketch mock-up of respiratory that we're kind of working on to get these drawings down.